Hello and welcome to this episode of Close Encounters, live from the National Gallery in Oslo. The talk will be held in English as per usual, but first some information in Norwegian for our Norwegian audience. Velkommen til denne episoden i serien Tett på fra Nasjonalmuseet. I kveld vi direkte inne fra studiesalen for grafikk og tegning på Nasjonalgalleriet. Og kveldens tema kunstneren Nikolai Astrup. Hovedbildet i kveld Fugl på sten. Seksjonsleder konservering Kari Greve og kuratorformidling Linn Staffne Fisler skal gi oss et innblikk i hans kunst og kunstnerskap. Og underveis i samtalen det mulig å stille spørsmål til Kari og Linn i kommentarfeltet, som vi skal svare på etter foredraget. Episoden vil bli tekstet på norsk i etterkant. Tonight we're back in the study room for prints and drawings, and we have head of conservation Kari Greve with us, together with curator education Linn Staffne Fisler, who will be introducing us to Nikolai Astrup. The main artwork today is Bird on a Stone, among some other artworks, and we will get to know the artist and his art. And if you have any questions along the way, feel free to ask them in the comment section below, and we will try to answer them after the talk. Over to you, Kari and Linn.
Thank you, Maria.
Thank you.
And welcome to all of you back home. We are very delighted to be able to present Nikolai Astrup to you this evening. Kari, you have studied Nikolai Astrup's work over many years here at the National Gallery. Mm. We are about to move out from this building now, so it's a special value of us to be sitting here right now.
Absolutely.
You have also published extensively yourself, but as we can see here, there have been a lot of
There have been many publications on Nikolai Astrup. Myself, I have been fortunate enough to be able to work with his woodcuts for, as you said, many years, many, many years, actually. And the result was this catalogue of the woodcuts, which was published some years ago. And when you look at all this, the man behind at least half of these publications is Øystein Loge, who we should mention especially. He was the first art historian to really immerse himself in Astrup's world and Astrup's oeuvre. And this book here was published in 1986. And is still a classic among people who want to know more about Astrup. Mm.
And there have been several exhibitions.
Yes.
The last publication, per now, is this one from an exhibition starting in 2016, right?
Yes, that's right.
Which also traveled abroad.
Yes, that was. This was an initiative and was sponsored by the Savings Bank Foundation, to promote Astrup abroad and make him known and to make him known among Europeans in this exhibition tour. It was it was an exhibition at Dulwich, outside of London, and it was in Emden in Germany. Mm. And now, this coming summer, there will be an exhibition at Clark Institute in Massachusetts.
Yes. So maybe some of you there have seen some of these exhibitions or will be seeing the one in Massachusetts this summer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. So if we look at Nikolai Astrup, we have... he was a Norwegian artist living from 1880 to 1928, so he died only 48 years old. Mm. But during his lifetime, he made a really considerable impact on Norwegian art. Mm. And how would you like to describe this, Kari?
Astrup is a very interesting artist. He was he lived his whole life in this remote village of Jølster, which incidentally has probably the most beautiful landscape in all of Norway, which is a country with a lot of beautiful landscapes. But he very soon found that his circle of motifs, they were all there, where he was actually, where he had grown up and where he moved back after a short sojourn abroad and in Christiania, where he he educated himself.
Yes, and we will get back to that. But I think it's important also to keep in mind that he really was an international.
Yes.
He had an international foundation in a way, the way he
yes,
was educated.
He did.
And he really got the impulses
yes,
from what was going on.
Even
up there.
Though he spent his life in Jølster, which was really, really remote also at this time because of bad roads and really it was far away from everything. But he kept an international art journal. He was totally aware of everything that was going on internationally. Mm. And from time to time, he managed to get a grant. And then he would be traveling and looking at art.
Yes. And his friends and artists were also visiting him in
Jølster.
Oh,
yes, absolutely.
So he was not a lone man in that way. So Jølster is situated on the western coast of Norway. Hmm. And maybe some of the two most known motifs to you there from Astrup is what we see here now on the screen, the Midsummer Bonfire, which he... I myself know it most from the paintings.
Mm. Yes.
And he made a lot of versions of these paintings. And what we see here right now is also a print.
Mm. Yes.
From the same motif. So, and this was something that he probably made on request. Many of these paintings, all the versions that he made were of it, because it became so popular. Mm. So not only today from people getting to know Astrup through maybe often this painting or what we see here now, The Spring Night in Cello,
yes,
which also started as a painting and then he made it into several printing versions.
Yes, a very popular woodcut. Mm. And I think for a Norwegian audience, I think if you mention the name Astrup to the man in the street, I think the bonfire would be the first association.
Yeah.
Which he, as you said, made a lot of versions of, both in especially in painting. I didn't know actually that there were so many until I saw the exhibition. For this catalog, and when we saw the exhibition in Henny Onstad, close to Oslo, there was a whole room full of bonfires.
Yeah.
So smaller and bigger, and bonfires all around the room. It was quite impressive.
Mm. So, still though, the next hour we will dig deeper into other works by Nikolai Astrup. And there's especially one artwork that have interested you the past years, Kari. Which one is that?
Yeah, well, I happen to love this print. I think it's a wonderful woodcut. I think it's one of Astrup's best.
Mm-hmm.
And when we started to talk about doing something about Astrup, it was my immediate thought that we really should have this print and talk about it. I will get back later, I think, into why I think it's such a great print and all the small details about it, but I just happen to love it.
Yes.
So. And then we had to have this, the foxgloves, as well, because that's one of Astrup's. That's his. What can you say? It's his most demanding and most his biggest endeavor, really. This woodcut here. We will talk about that as well.
Yes. So, looking at how Astrup's international career started. This will also lead us soon to his development artistically that we can see the results of here. But he studied in Kristiania, as Oslo was called back then, and took classes in Harriet Backer's painting school, and even print classes at the Royal School of Drawing.
Mm.
And then he moved to Paris and studied at one of the most acknowledged private schools, Académie Colle Rossi. And Christian Krog was one of his teachers there, and he gave him his best recommendation and really thought that this would be one of the greatest Norwegian artists in the coming generation.
Mm.
So if we Those years in Paris, we know that he got a lot of inspiration through walking to museums and really drawing after masters.
Yes.
And which international artists do you think inspired him the most at that time, Kari?
Well, what I think is very interesting when we talk about woodcuts is the fact that this is probably where he encountered what he later called the modern woodcut.
Yeah.
Through the hands of the Japanese, you know, the Japanese artists, mm-hmm. Japanese woodcuts, they were really a big thing in Paris at this time. There were exhibitions by Japanese artists, and we know that Astrup studied them thoroughly.
Yeah.
As you can see here.
Yes, we see here the this is from Astrup's sketchbook. Mm. 36 views towards the Fuji Mountains, which is was Hokusai's work. And I myself believe that this was also an inspiration for Astrup when he returned to Jølster. Mm. And I think it is Øystein Loge who notes that or found in the notes of Nikolai Astrup that he has sort of counted all the views, possible views, from the old buildings in Jølster, where he could have motifs from. So he has sort of written, given them all names, and really methodologically has sort of made a plan of which motifs from Jølster would be relevant. So I think this is maybe an inspiration that he got already from Hokusai in these
that
early years.
That is very interesting, and probably a direct influence from Hokusai's views of Mount Fuji.
Yes.
And apart from Japanese woodcuts, he would have seen the woodcuts of artists like Félix Vallotton, the Swiss artist. We have an example of his fantastic use of black and white in his woodcuts. They are so simplified and they are so expressive, and it must have made an impression on Astrup.
Yes.
And Gauguin, of course, was also doing woodcuts at the time. And we have to remember that woodcuts were not a known graphic printing art. It was woodcut had been traditionally used for illustrations.
Yes,
where you would use the end piece of the wood and make art illustrations for newspapers and things like that in the years before the photography and the printing press took over. So to make a woodcut as an artwork was something quite new.
Yes, and it took quite a long time before it was acknowledged as art on a line.
Yes,
with,
absolutely.
With painting. Mm. One of the most famous artworks by Hokusai is this wave, which we can assume that Nikolai Astrup also saw during these exhibitions. Mm. And it's we can see several examples. We'll see a couple of them later today, where probably a direct inspiration also from this print.
Yeah, and Nikolai he made Astrup's his own work. Little wave as well.
Yes. Exactly.
The big wave. Excuse me, Astrup. It's the big wave, not the little wave. And so he was obviously influenced by Japanese art. But on the other hand, you see that he studies it. You see that he is very well aware of the Japanese technique in making woodcuts. But he doesn't really go into it because he knows that the Japanese, they use water-based printing ink, for instance. Astrup never goes there.
Yeah.
He uses oil and oil paint, which was a medium that he really knew and knew how to deal with. So that's what he uses.
And it was very complicated, the Japanese way of doing it. It was maybe that's the reason. I think both
could
him and also Edvard Munch, who was the other Norwegian artist, who was and the one who had the earliest experiments, as far as we know,
yes,
with woodcut. His first prints or his first he sort of discovers the woodcut in 1896. And this print from 1899 is an early version of his experiment with the woodcut. And we see a woman's head against the shore. And here we wanted to show you a bit of the technique to sort of reveal how you would work with a woodcut. Here you can see one of the... it had to be carved from wood plates, and you would see... you would have to print from the same plate or from several plates on the same paper. So you can see the sort of the first print. And here you see the wood plates. And both of these plates were necessary to sort of create the finished example. And Edvard Munch used this to he was a colorist. He wanted to experience with color. And you can see here the lines where he actually has used a jigsaw to cut out and create sort of a puzzle technique with the wooden plate, and this made it more efficient.
Of course, and it's ingenious because you can color the different parts and you can put them together and smack you have a print with the two colors in one.
Yes,
it's brilliant.
Yeah,
and this was his own invention, I think,
wasn't it? Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
And you can also see, or just note a difference that's typical for Munch, but that we don't see in Astrup's woodcuts, and that's you can actually see the lines in the wood.
Yeah, the grain of the wood.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
So this is, and this is of course for also Munch as a painter, you'd also see the canvas in his paintings.
Yeah.
Whereas Astrup is a very pastose
painter. Yes, he is, and a pastose printer as well.
Yes, exactly.
But you have, and for instance, when you think of Munch's, I don't think we have it here, but the kiss.
Yes.
Where you have this, the grain is melting into the fluid bodies of the two people kissing.
Yes.
And where he really uses the nature of the wood in the print.
Yes.
Astrup never does that.
No.
He never really shows the material with which he is printing.
Yeah, which we see here. It's a very different way of... a very different approach.
Yeah. So this is his first... this is the very first print, probably. There is another one he might have been carving even earlier, but this one is dated 1904, and it's dated in the printing block itself.
Mm.
So, and he writes about this, that he was carving it in a wood that was too thin because he had no experience.
Yeah.
So he was choosing a plate that was too thin. So he had to, he has later embedded it in another piece of wood.
Exactly.
As you can see, I think you can all see it in the printing plate there.
And we... one of the questions we were wanting to sort of reveal also to the audience here is the connection between Edvard Munch and Astrup as printers.
Mm.
I mean, Astrup was much younger than Munch, obviously, but he... Mm. It seems that their interest in the woodcut has come from the same Japanese inspiration.
Yes.
And not through each other.
No.
But they obviously, Munch was a fan also of Astrup as a young artist, and we know that actually he bought three of his prints.
Yes, he did, including this one. The small self-portrait was one version of it, not this one, I think, but another version of it was bought by Edvard Munch.
Yeah, and this is the only note that we can find in Astrup's writings, and he wrote a lot.
Yes, he wrote a lot, and I think that if he actually had met Munch and even talked to him, I think he would have mentioned it perhaps not only once, but several times in his letters. He didn't do that.
Yeah.
So the probability is that although they shared some connections and common friends, I don't think they ever actually met. But Astrup was very proud that Munch owned three of his friends.
That's nice. Now, yeah. Kari, maybe we should move to Bird on Stone.
Yes.
Which is our main focus today. And would you like to share some of the fascinating aspects of this print?
Well, I think I will start by reading you Astrup's own description of the mood behind this motif, because I think it's a beautiful poetic text. I hope it's not too long. Bear with me, but it's Astrup writes really well. I have to say, if he hadn't become a pictorial artist, he could have been an author, because he's really, really good writer. Mm. So it's a pure joy to read his letters. And what he writes about this motif is the following. We live here on the shady side of the lake. And in the spring, when the sun has finally, after an absence of 6 months, started to draw closer from behind the mountains, we exist in a continual state of sun-blinded longing for the other side of the lake, which has already for ages been bathed in glorious sunshine from over the thawing hills and snow-capped peaks, whilst we, on this side, have been in the shade the whole day, or maybe have just managed to catch a glimpse of the sun for a couple of minutes during the day. At these times, we can often feel a strong desire to go down to the water, where there is a little less snow and where a few of the snow-capped peaks, so dazzling in the sunlight, are carried atop the water's ripples to our feet here on our own shore. And we begin to understand that we too will finally soon have spring here on the shady side. The air is filled with catkins. You feel spring coming as if through a web of branches. And it starts to come to life even amongst the barren rocks and moss. The sap is already flowing in the young shoots, and even the stumps of the chopped down alders have enough juice to weep a final time.
It's beautiful.
It's beautiful. It's so beautiful. And it makes you understand the background for the print. The original, the first version of this motif is not a print, it's a painting. And you can see when you look at this painting and you later look at the print again, you can see that the motif is in the print is actually a what do you call it? Mirrored.
Yes.
Mirrored version of the motif in the first painting. Mm. The painting is from 1905, and his first tryout here for the print is not long after the first painting. Mm. He made this print. He says himself that it was fairly easy to print. So as opposed to some other of his woodcuts like this one, this was fairly easy to print. And so he says to his agents and his customers that he can offer it in a long range of different moods. Mm. So, and we have a whole series of different moods. Sometimes it will be a bright blue sunny day, or else it would be a more like an evening atmosphere, and or still other moods. I think one of the most beautiful one here is a very bright blue one, where he has also heightened the sky a little bit, so it gets more even more longer version of the motif. One of the most beautiful versions I know, we don't really have a version of here, but a picture of here, but it's printed on a greenish paper, which also makes a beautiful impression.
Yeah. But I wonder, why do you think this print was easy to sort of reproduce or to create different versions of?
I think there are four printing blocks. Yes, we have them here.
Mm-hmm.
Four printing blocks, and the one you see to the left now is the so-called key block, where you have all the lines and the main composition, and then you have three other blocks for all the middle tones and the details.
Yeah.
And the format is not too big, so he didn't risk that the blocks would warp or behave strangely. And he probably could get a quite a good result without having to print too many times on top of each other.
Yeah.
Because of the transparency of the motif itself, and the possibility also to let the paper tone shine through in some cases.
Mm. But he needed all these four blocks for each.
Yes, he
print.
Did. He did. Mm. And you know, with Astrup, four blocks is the rule, so to speak, or the regular, his regular amount of printing blocks for the woodcuts. But that didn't mean that he only printed four times. Mm. He would use the same blocks over and over and over again,
mm-hmm.
and paint on them with different colors, print again. And so one single print or woodcut can consist of up to 20 rounds of printing.
Mm.
So in this case, I have not counted how many rounds I think he printed, but perhaps a little bit more than four.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And when you look at this, when you look at the print and you look at the composition, which is so, it is decorative.
Mm-hmm.
It is a bit abstract or abstracted, and some of the elements are really decorative and makes you think of Japanese.
Yes, that was
cherry blossoms. I think you mentioned the cherry blossoms, and this little. Fantastic! It's the main character.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so depicted so sparingly. It's just black and white, and a little bit of white, and poof, there is the bird.
And this Japanese element that we can see in several Nordic artists at the time is it characteristic of the high horizon, that you see little of the skyline, and that you have these sort of foreground elements of wood or trees or branches or something in the foreground. But there's also one more element in this print that is sort of leads us to think of Japanism,
and that is the signature. So it is so this is, I think, very obvious that he is imitating the signature that you would find, or the prints, the stamps that you would find in Japanese woodcuts, and this is, I think, very consciously made that way.
Yeah.
He doesn't do it in any other woodcut.
Yeah.
It's only here.
Yeah.
So it's a little nod to his Japanese forefathers in printmakers. Another thing that is worth mentioning, not only for this woodcut, but in all Astrup's woodcuts, is his tendency to paint.
Yeah.
He called it retouching his prints after they had been printed. You know, the regular way of printing a color woodcut would be to, you know, you print the colors and then you print them on top of each other, and voila, there is the print.
Mm.
And Astrup is a painter, and he can't stop himself.
Yeah.
He has to embellish on this on the color prints. He has to make a little thing here and there. And he says, he says he knows it's not right to do it.
Yeah, because it's ashamed, isn't it?
It's almost ashamed. I know it's not right to do it.
Yes.
Because also because if you have a printed surface, then a painted stroke will always stand out.
Yes.
At least to a trained eye, it will.
Yeah.
So
it's too easy. It's cheating.
Yes, it's a bit cheating. It's a bit cheating.
Yeah.
So he's so he does it. I mean, almost always does it. So here, I don't know if you have the possibility to zoom in on this, the stone in the foreground here. It should be possible to see that it has strokes of rather pastose paint here and there to indicate moss, I guess. And if you look at these, the green in the branches here, it is also made by a brush. So he was obviously he was not quite satisfied with the with the color of the branches. He had to make them more green, and so he took his brush and he made it a little bit stronger.
Yeah, and maybe we could talk about also this his way of working with the prints and to. He doesn't really give them any number, does he? There's no like limited editions.
No editions, and that makes it a little bit hard for us now to know how many impressions he actually made of each print, because he had his wood blocks. He saved his wood, so he would carve them on both sides, and he would keep them in his house. And then he would, from time to time, he would get a an order from a customer that might have seen a bird on a stone in someone's house, and writes to Astrup and said, "I would like one of those," and then he goes and he makes a print.
Yeah, but he doesn't really reprint.
No, it's always unique.
Yes, because then he has this idea that he says himself that he values a print. A par with a painting, that it's just as valuable, it's just as much art.
Yes.
Talking about this earlier, and but he has. It seems like he's in order to do so, to stand behind it, he has to do a new variation. It has to be a unique kind of print every time he gets a new order.
Yeah, he writes about that as well, and he says that it would be too boring just to make a new exactly the same.
Yeah,
it has to be something new, something different. And sometimes he actually carves a new detail into the plate. That happens more often than not. And he works a lot with his coloring and with his color scheme, and he makes a totally new mood in the print. And I think that is because every print is unique, and he views them as totally separate artworks. This makes him quite original as an artist. Because this is not your typical printmaker.
No.
This is not how typical printmakers work.
Yeah.
This is a painter.
And like Edvard Munch, he looks at the plate itself. He keeps them and looks at them as almost artworks in themselves.
Yes.
So the printing plates are all kept.
They are all kept.
For later.
They were kept in his house, and in a couple of instances, he would have been a bit, he wouldn't have been so thorough in cleaning them. So he describes in some instances that he goes to fetch one of the printing, the plates, and he looks at it and it's just full of hardened oil paint and it's just impossible to work with. So he says, I thought I would make a new impression of this one, but now it's a mess, so I will have to carve a new plate.
Yeah.
So he did that from time to time, but mostly he kept his stock of printing plates as a thing to continually print from.
Mm. And you said earlier that this print was inspired or sort of deriving from a painting.
Yes.
But we can also see that this print leads to
yes, that's true.
Another
yes,
painting.
Absolutely, it does. Here he has this painting here was made in 1913, and you can see how it copies almost in detail the elements from the woodcut.
Mm-hmm.
So it starts with a painting. From the painting, it becomes a woodcut, and from the woodcut, it again becomes a new painting.
Yeah, where he added something. I'm sure you can see that yourself. The little tree or the
He has added a
branch.
What is it? A juniper bush?
Yes.
Something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, to the right there, and made it so the whole format changes, of course, and more mountains get fit into the motif.
Yes. And this was also, maybe we should look at this these other examples
yes.
that we have
we
here
should.
Behind us,
yeah.
where he worked in the same way, actually. But this connection between painting and print is not that obvious.
No, it's not.
Not at the first glance.
In this case, it is not. What is very interesting here, and I think you just have to take my word for it, because it's difficult to see, but when you look at this, the painting, it is very, it has rather rough brushwork and is very pastos and painterly painted, so to speak. And then you look at the foliage here, which is has a whole different character. It is flatter, and it's very, very detailed, lace. Green lace coming here.
Mm.
And this foliage is actually printed
yes.
on the canvas.
And you can compare to this print of the same foxgloves.
So if you see, I will point to this very characteristic. How can I do
it's
this?
It's like an epsilon.
I have to go my hand. It's like an epsilon there.
Mm.
And then you have this foliage piece over there with a branch coming out.
Which is repeating itself here.
You
it's the
see
same thing.
The exact same thing there.
Mm.
And for date nerds, this is quite interesting because this means that a printing block for this print must have been made already in 1909. But the first version of this print is from 1920.
Yes, it's very interesting.
So
a long
it's
time.
Very interesting.
Mm.
So,
and it's only a trained eye can discover this. I must say, it's really even having been so close, it's really hard to see that
yes,
this is printed.
Yes, and at this point, I would like to give credit where credit is due, because this was actually pointed out to me by a colleague, a painting conservator, Magnil Aasen, who discovered this. I had not seen it myself, but when she pointed it out to me, I went bloop like this, because it had a great significance for the dating of the printing block.
Yes, and this is what we could call a painterly print, actually, if we move to this one then, because
yes.
it's here he's printing on the. On the canvas.
The canvas, yes.
And here again, like we saw with Bird on the Stone, he has actually also painted details on the print of foxgloves.
Yes.
And this, we have to go very close to see these white little dots on the foxgloves themselves.
Yeah.
In order to discover this.
Every single little white blob there is has been done with a brush.
Yes.
So just to mention one little detail, it's almost a giveaway for an original Astrup print is that he has been there somewhere with his brush.
Yes,
it's
impossible to see if you don't professional, because it's this is very there are so many elements here that are quite what you say, pastel, so you can see yes. they look so, sort of too thick to be a print, mm. but they yes. are actually printed.
Yes.
So it's hard to see the difference.
This print is amazing. It was printed in 20, he had 20 rounds of printing. Mm. With only 3 printing blocks,
yes.
but he used them and reused them over and over again, up to 20 times. Mm. And he had to dry, because he used oil paint, it had to dry between yes. each printing. Mm. So he would hang them up to dry with the clothes pins like this, and then wait until the printing, the paint had dried enough to make a second round. Mm.
And the reason also which complicated the whole thing is that it's so such a huge format.
Yes.
So it sort of expands what you can actually do from a wooden plate, which I think that's maybe the maximum you could have from,
yeah, well,
from one.
Least, yeah. yeah.
But it's sort of, so he needed these 3 or 4 blocks to...
Yeah, mm. he had. Yeah, and they made him a lot of trouble. Mm. So he had to. They had warped, and they had because they were put together by several pieces of wood, and they warped, and they were really impossible to make. And when you think, when you make a color wood cut, yeah, here you can see. Mm. You see the. You see the two pieces mm. of wood
yes.
Put together, and he describes this very vividly in his letters, how he's struggling with this horrible print, and he promises himself he will never make another one, and then a customer comes along and says, oh, please, 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 you have to make one for me, just for yes. me, just one more, and then he starts over again. Mm. So it was a huge struggle, and he and when you print the color woodcut, and you have to have these very precise, it has to fit exactly yes. in the right place, and when you have a warped printing plate, and also he was the way he was printing, he put the printing plate down. He had put his oil paints on it. He put the paper down, and then he used all his force. He didn't have a printing press or anything. Mm. He used his hands and his force to push the paper down mm. and into the printing plate. Mm. So it was a very strenuous work for him.
Yes.
And especially with formats as big as this.
Yes. And if we zoom into some of the details, I think we can also see some of the Japanese inspiration also in foxgloves. Mm. Not least to mention the mountain behind mm. here, which yes. sort of recalls Fuji from Hokusai.
It's a real Mount Fuji there.
So it's the Fuji in Jølster.
Yeah.
And also here the details in the waterfall, which mm. really resembles the wave.
Yes, it does.
From Hokusai, and also mm. His own wave that he made this yes. woodcut of, which is obviously some of the same elements.
Mm. I hope you can see it. You can get the details, because it's mm. so beautifully rendered.
Yes.
It's really, really nice.
And maybe you can take us, Kari, to these nature motifs that are so important to Nikolai Astrup. They're often without figures. Mm. Often mm. the humans are lacking. Here mm. we see children. And these yes. are his own children, right?
Yes, that's Petra and Kari picking mm. blueberries.
Mm-hmm. And you had a theory why this landscape was so important to him.
He is. He recurs to the theme of nature in Jølster his whole life. It's mm. it's his life project, mm-hmm. and he grew up there, as we said in to begin with, and I think also it is a personal some of his personal history has had a big contribution here, because he was asthmatic and he was suffering greatly from asthma as a child. And his father was the local vicar, and they were living in the parsonage, and the house was old and rotting and moldy and horrible conditions for a person with asthma. So as a child, Nikolai would wake up in the middle of the night and couldn't breathe, and he had to go out. So he would go out into the nature, where he would struggle to get air, and then he, when it passes, and he wakes up, so to speak, comes out of it, and then he looks around, and then he sees the nature, and he sees these incredibly strong impressions of the nature in Jølsted, which is, as I said, it is to all objective eyes fabulous. The Danish author Carsten Jensen, who is himself an asthmatic, he has written an essay which made an impression on me, because he says that when you are recovering, or when you are coming out of such an asthmatic fit, your senses are heightened to a fantastic degree. You are so aware of everything that's going on, and you sense everything much, much stronger. I think that is an important point. I will always remember that essay because it made for me an aha moment when it comes to Astrup and his project to recreate, which he always says, to recreate the impressions, that the nature impressions from when he was a child.
Yes, and these childhood memories are sort of manifest themselves in his paintings.
Yes,
from all these views of Jølsted.
Yes,
and this might also be, he mentions, for instance, Rousseau as one of his great inspirations.
Yes,
also, so this. Maybe also
this
be
naivistic approach.
Yes, and the childhood view of things, which inspired him already as a student in back in Paris.
Yes.
And many have asked how he decided to sort of withdraw already in 1902, after his 3 years education, to withdraw to Jølsted and never really move away from there. And one of his main reasons, sort of the main reason, was that this is where he found his material. This was what he was supposed to do. He was a home place painter. And he claims himself to be one of the painters in the country who most who are most attached to location and landscape. And this landscape full of legend, as he describes it. So he spent his whole time in Jølsted, but had a hard time to find sort of a place to stay. One of his last paintings is from the farm where he grew
parsonage.
Up, actually, the parsonage.
Yeah.
But he moved to Sandalstrand.
Yes.
And got his own place and grew his own vegetables and
it's like he was quite a gardener.
Yes,
and he was experimenting also there. He was experimenting with hybrids of different species and trying to make a new growth. And actually, he has Astrup has a lot of written. There's a lot of written material, and one of the first when I was starting to study his letters and notebooks and all of that. One of the first notebooks I came across, the first description there was a description of how to pod an apple tree.
Ah, really?
Yes. And a very long description.
Yeah.
And I thought, what is this? Am I interested in art? What's going on here? It was all about apple trees and on rhubarb and on everything else in the garden.
Yeah.
Actually, now at Sandalstrand, there is a at Astrup Tune, there is a project going on with a recreation of Astrup's garden. And a landscape architect, Ingeborg Melgren Mathisen, is involved in this project, which is funded by the Savings Bank Foundation. Yes. And they are going to recreate Astrup's garden there.
Oh,
and that will really be fantastic to experience. Yeah. We didn't talk about the different versions of this print, but maybe we can show them because what you are seeing now is the first version, which was made for his friend Pierre Kramer, and for this print, Astrup describes that he wanted to make a present for Kramer's kids, and it was like a present from his own kids. Mm. So he wanted this to hang in the children's bedroom and be a kind of a fairy tale-y, childish atmosphere.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
So he made altogether five of these prints, and we know every single one of them because of his extensive letter writing. We know when he made them and for whom and how much he toiled with them, and so we know quite a lot of these five prints, and they differ in mood. Typically for Astrup, some of them are a bit darker in the coloring, and some of them are brighter. And
the background, the landscape,
and the landscape
is always different.
This is the only one with the Fuji.
Yes,
the other ones have different mountains, and these are painted on the printing block and printed like that, like a monotype.
Yes. It's fascinating.
Yeah.
But he really, it must have been a nightmare, I think, to him, all this,
horrible,
this process.
Horrible. And it broke down his health as well.
Yeah.
But, you know, this was an expensive print.
Yeah.
So I think that was also a temptation.
Yeah, a motivation.
Yeah, he had his economies were not that great. And he didn't really know how to deal with money at all. His wife was more, had a more pecuniary sense, and so she was pestering him, by the way, to start a fox farm.
Oh, really?
Because there was a lot of money in a fox farm, so she was always on him to that they should start a fox farm there in Sandalstrand. It never happened.
And Engel, she's the one we see in the painting, a spring evening in Jølster.
Yes,
isn't it?
Yes, yes.
And she was local.
She was a local farmer's girl.
Yes,
and she was. She was not 16 yet when they married, so that was a bit of a scandal as well. It was scandalous enough that the son of the vicar married a local farmer's girl.
Yes.
That was really not done.
Mm.
And then she was, almost just barely an adult when they married. But they stayed married and they got 8 children.
Mm.
And when Astrup died, Engel was just 36, was sitting there with 8 small children to provide for.
Yeah.
So that was quite tough.
Mm. Yeah. So we see her here in the painting. She's picking rhubarb, and we know that the rhubarb had a special meaning, didn't it, to them?
Yes. Well, they made rhubarb wine.
Yes.
And and you can see that the rhubarb wine was often accompanying Astrup in the evenings when he was writing his letters, because you can actually see the rhubarb wine taking hold, and the letters become bigger and bigger, and he gets more and more excited when he writes about some unfairness that has happened to him or something like that.
Yeah.
So that was a staple, I think, in the Astrup home. So maybe they will start making it again now at Astrup Tune when they get their new crops in.
Yes, and you've been there, of course. But
yes, I
must
have.
Yes, And it's we can see here the
it looks so beautiful.
It's really
It is. It is. It's a beautiful place, and of course, when you think that you live there with 8 children, it's perhaps not so, you know, idyllic. Mm. But wonderful, wonderful nature, and absolutely beautiful place. Mm. And rhubarb wine or no rhubarb wine, I think everybody should pay a visit to the Astruptuna this summer.
Yes, I'm definitely going there. Actually,
yes. Good.
And it's everything is kept. The way it was when Astrup lived there.
Yes,
so that's
it is.
Another good reason for going there.
It is. You get so close to Astrup when you visit there.
Yes. So we all look forward to that when we are able to travel again after these times.
Absolutely.
And if there are any questions from the audience, this is the time, maybe?
Yes. We've gotten a few questions. And a lot of comments. So we'll start with the first one, which is from Arlene Joy. In the international context, do you know of any other artists who chose to work in very isolated places and yet managed to gain recognition in their lifetime? I ask because it seems odd that he won recognition at all.
Well, the most the one who springs to mind is Gauguin.
Yes,
I mean nothing could be more remote than Tahiti, where he chose to.
Yes.
So I think it was a bit also. This was a national project.
Yes, and it was not unusual actually. After the industrialization, a lot of artists turned home to where they sort of had their roots. Mm. And even Edvard Munch, for instance, who we were talking about, he also withdrew from his international life in Berlin and Paris and moved to Ekely, where he painted a lot of paintings. Mm. But I think it's, internationally. I don't come of at the spring, but it's this homebound. It's very important for a lot of artists at the time.
Mm. I think so too, and it's also perhaps can be seen in light of the, you know, going back to the what is real.
Yes.
And the French painters going to Bretagne and the Pont-Aven school, and you have this to find the roots of everything, to find the originality, the authenticity, so to speak, and. For Astrup, he had it all there. It was his childhood place.
Mm. Thank you. Then we have a question from Karianne. Let's see where it went. There. Very curious about his woodcuts. I wonder if he saw the Japanese Monet collection together with Klog or the tableau, or he might have started before with the woodcuts. Do you know anything about that?
I didn't understand which exhibition did he see?
The Japanese Monet collection.
Oh yeah, Monet's collection of woodcuts.
Yes.
Yeah.
I don't think he saw that.
No.
I don't think so. But I think that collecting Japanese woodcuts was a big thing in Paris.
Yes.
In 1901, when he was there, it was a thing to do. So he must have seen Japanese woodcuts in many places.
Yes, and it also among the artists in Christiania, they would have Christian Krog, and then they would also have. It was sort of known to a lot of artists at the time, so it was a big thing in the 1890s. Yeah.
And then we have a question from Brenda, who's watching from Canada. What kind of wood did he use for the woodcuts?
Ah. This you have to answer.
Yes. Well, he used several types of wood. He used alder, and he also used fruit trees, wood from his fruit trees. Mm. So he and he says pear tree is very good, and cherry tree is also a good wood to carve in. And of course, the local alder, which was abundantly there. So it's local wood that he used.
Mm. Very nice. Then we have a question from Thailand, from Kevin. Did any of his children become painters?
Well, his youngest son, Nikolai, was also working as a... he was printing... he also printed from his father's blocks, and he made some... he also made art. But none of them became artists in the same, what can you say, in the same league as Nikolai Senior. Mm.
Okay, then we have the last question, I think, for today, which is from Liv. What is it about the tree stumps so much in the focus in paintings and prints? And then someone is commenting back that maybe he had to chop some trees down to get the view.
Exactly.
Yes. Oh, yes. Sort of create his own.
Yeah. Thank you, everybody, for all questions and for watching. Mm.
Thank you to Lynn and Kari for this inspiring and thrilling conversation. And we will be back with another episode in this series called Close Encounters in the middle of May. And the star of the show then will be bridal possession on the Hardangerfjord, or Brudfeden I Hardanger, which is one of Norway's most famous paintings. And remember that you can always watch the episodes again on YouTube and Facebook with subtitles in Norwegian and English. And you can see those with other digital events and talks we have. So thank you all for watching, and have a nice evening.